Good morning, good morning, good morning. All I can say is, wow. I truncated my vacation in Cabo with my family. We do an annual vacation. We take all the kids, the grandchildren. That started on Wednesday. I got the call from Phil maybe a month or so ago, and I said, I have to be here. I want to immerse myself in the culture of FFS and the Lisa Initiative. I wanted to be in the environment. I wanted to touch and feel the spirit of the people of this incredible organization. And this has been one of the most fulfilling, one of the most exciting, one of the most inspiring 3 days of my life. You have made my week. What a night you had last night. I sat there. It's the most exercise I have gotten in the last 2 weeks as I sat and clapped and sat and clapped. And 4 hours of that, I think I burned like, 500 calories. It was awesome. It was awesome. It really was. I mean, God bless you. Let me just say, may God grant me the words to speak your thoughts. This morning, I want to give a special thanks to my good friend, Shirley Johnson, who inducted me into this initiative, and for her role that she has played in helping the African American community get invested and involved in the Lisa Initiative, for her pioneering work. She's one of the matriarchs of the Lisa Initiative. For her leadership and for her production last night, she marched up on this stage several times. I just want to say to you, Shirley, you are a gift to black people. You are a gift to FFS, and you have been a gift to me, and I praise you and I honor you for that. Thank you. To our Hispanic brothers and sisters who marched up on the stage, thank you for serving and giving back and investing in your people, your culture, and your community. To our white brothers and sisters who are interestingly in the minority, I have been speaking in the insurance industry for a decade. I have never, ever seen this. This is completely the reverse. So this is revolutionary and it is evolutionary. And so to our white brothers and sisters, thank you for the courage to immerse yourself in an environment of true, if not dominant, multiculturalism. This is a strong signal of where America will be and ultimately where America will thrive in the 21st century. And to our Asian brothers and sisters, you folks do not waste any time. I want to thank you, and Debbie alluded to this as well. I want to thank you for your humility. I want to thank you for your discipline, your work ethic, your consciousness, your team building and teamwork, your fellowship. One of the real strong things about our Asian brothers and sisters is their ability to be good followers and to produce incredible leaders. I want to thank you for your execution. You execute, and I want to thank you for your love. You are awesome. And very competitive. So in the spirit of competition, I see that you have thrown the gauntlet down. You have set the standards by which all of us will be judged. We, all of us, must pick up this gauntlet. And in the spirit of cooperation, competition, or collaboration, we must meet the challenge of succeeding and bringing into our cultures and into our communities all that you have so lovingly done with your community. You are a model, and we love you for that. Thank you very much. Phil and Debbie, what can I say? You are the future. You are risk takers. You are visionaries. And every time you two think, you strengthen our nation. So you keep on thinking. We love you. And Phil, where's Phil? Is Phil around here? Yeah, there's Phil around. What a great sense of humor, brilliant man. And I just want to say to you, Phil, if I could not be me, I would want to be you. I don't know if Mehran is in the audience at this moment. I know he speaks after me. What an incredible guy. I mean, what a visionary, and what a gem we have on our side. I got a chance to spend some up close and personal time with him last night, and I just never met anyone in the insurance industry quite like this revolutionary, this visionary. So thank you, Mehran, and thank you for all that you have done for us. I don't have much time. I roll out of here to join my family later this afternoon in Cabo. Yes, it's hard work, but somebody has to do it. And I just want to say just a couple of things to begin my remarks. I promise you two simple things. The first thing I promise you is that I will not be saying anything you have not already heard before, but this morning you're going to hear it differently. Understanding that everything happens for a reason and serves us in some special way, and we will never understand that reason looking forward, and we will only understand it looking backwards. The great Carl Jung, Swiss psychologist Carl Jung, called this synchronicity. The seemingly accidental intermeshing of meaningless circumstances. And what he discovered in his life's work is that there are no meaningless circumstances, that you are always where you are supposed to be. And this morning, you are supposed to be here. And whoever is sitting next to you is supposed to be sitting next to you. If there's an empty seat next to you, it is supposed to be empty. Yes, it is. And as someone said, yes, we all understand that when the students are ready, the teachers will appear, not 1 minute late and not 1 minute early. So thank you for being here this morning. That's the first thing I promise. The second thing I promise is what Elizabeth Taylor promised her 8 husbands. And that is, I will not be keeping you long. That's right. It has been mentioned several times about time, and I said earlier about our Asian brothers and sisters, you waste no time. So I'm going to talk a little bit about time this morning. I'm going to talk a little bit about leadership, a little bit about why wealth is important, a little bit about networking, a subject that is near and dear to my heart, a little bit about toxic people and building winning teams. And making a difference. I preface my remarks by a passage from the Bible, a direct quote from Jesus Christ. There are not many direct quotes from Jesus Christ in the Bible. It is John 5:30. And Jesus said, I of my own self can do nothing. Now this was Jesus. Jesus couldn't get it done on his own. By himself in a vacuum. So what's up with you? Why would you think you could do anything significant, anything worth talking about on your own by yourself in a vacuum? It is not possible. This passage says to me that we were born to network, that we were born to collaborate, that we were born to work with and through each other, that we were born to go through stages of dependence, independence, and ultimately interdependence, linked together in a common bond of caring and sharing. This is a powerful idea. It is best illustrated by what I see in this room, what I saw last night. The collaboration of teams fulfilling a vision that we all want to see become standard in an industry that is stale is powerful. But we do not have much time. Let me just get serious with you here for a minute. Now, I am very sensitive about time. Why am I sensitive? I'm 70 years old. I know I look 35 or 40. But you know, black don't crack, right? But the truth is that the average black male in America today lives to be 73. So if I'm lucky, I got 3 more years. If I'm lucky. Let us pray that God will bless me with more years than that. So I will tell anybody, do anything but don't waste my time. I will get more money, but I will not get any more time. And I don't know how much time I have, and I don't want to know. So, brothers and sisters, don't waste your time. Now, how will you know that you're wasting your time? If you could leave this business tomorrow and be happy, you're in the wrong damn business. See, that went over a lot of people's head. If you could stop doing this in the morning and be happy, you're in the wrong business. Not only that, I know that if you are not happy doing this business because you are prepared to leave, you're probably mediocre. I have never met anyone who hated what they were doing and was good at it. So my advice to you, and Debbie said this, my advice to you, if you are not happy doing this business, this awesome visionary business, this lucrative business that serves so many, leave. Stop messing up this business. Stop messing up the team that you're working on. Leave. And go find what God has put you here to do. That each of us has been put here with a unique purpose in mind. There's a job that God has assigned only you to do. And if you do not do it, it will not get done in the universe. And that's ultimately what will make you happy. If this does not make you happy, you are wasting your time and you don't know how much time you have. When you think about it, Mozart had 35 years. Mozart had 35 years to create some of the greatest music in the history of the world. God gave his own son 33 and a half years to change the world. Don't waste your time. Every moment and every minute is precious. Let me say that a little bit differently. Imagine that there is a bank account that credits your account each morning with $86,400 and it carries over no balance from day to day. Every evening, the bank deletes whatever part of the balance you failed to use during the day. What would you do? You would draw out every cent, wouldn't you? Absolutely. Each of us has such a bank. It is called the Bank of Time. Every morning, it credits you with 86,400 seconds. Every night, it writes off as lost whatever of this you have failed to invest to a good purpose. It carries over no balance, it allows no overdraft, and each day it opens a new account for you. Each night, it burns the remains of the day. Spend your time wisely. I've spent a good part of my life trying to help our people understand the need for leadership in the context of our community. Personal leadership first, because if you cannot lead yourself, you cannot lead anyone. Personal leadership. You are leaders. I said this on Wednesday when I came. You are leaders. You are servant leaders. We are in a period in this country where there is no more use for transactional leadership and transitional leadership. What we need is transformational leadership. And our transformational leaders are our servant leaders. And our servant leaders are our most humble, our most reverent, our most open, our most respectful, our most teachable, and our most caring leaders. You are those leaders. Leadership is the art of mobilizing others to want to struggle for shared aspirations and ultimately taking personal responsibility for growing and owning their own lives. To be a leader is to be awake and alert and to be dissatisfied at all times. Yes, we have come a long way, but we have much further to go. Therefore, I am not happy, but I am motivated by a positive anger directed towards positive change. What do I know about change? I know that you will never change that which you tolerate, and you will only change when you get angry. People will not change when they see the light. They will change when they feel the heat. And we are feeling the heat. Cultural minorities in this country, middle-class people are feeling the heat. And you were born to assuage and to help and to heal. And that's what you do, and that's what we do. Leadership is influence. Who are we influencing? We're influencing our children, because if our children cannot see the future, they will not pay the price. That every single thing we do, brothers and sisters, we do it for our children. Just as everything as our parents did, they did for us. That's leadership. Leadership is action. It's not some appointed position. I see your mouth running, but what are you doing? My daddy taught me many years ago, what you do speaks so loudly, I can't hear what you say. What are you doing? That's what leadership is. Leaders understand that everything begins with words. And from words comes consciousness. From consciousness comes passion. From passion comes action. From action comes change. And yes, this is evolutionary, not revolutionary. We didn't get this way overnight. We're not going to solve the complex issues of this great country overnight. Let me say that another way. We have a tradition in my family. We wash our own laundry. We raise our own children. We clean up our own dirt. Why? Because we rob ourselves when we refuse to choose to take responsibility for our own. We must all learn to stand straight and to love ourselves and to own our own lives. The power to be happy or miserable lies within us. When we give away our power to choose, look what they made me do, or it's the government's job, we should be very sure we know what we are getting in return. We are responsible. Leaders understand why wealth is important. We've been talking about that for 3 days, but so many of our communities have no clue on why money and wealth is important. Not so that we can buy more stuff. We don't need any more stuff. In the African American community, I say all the time, we are the only culture in the history of humankind that put political power before economic power. And last year in the black community, we elected over 9,000 black public officials, and we're still at the bottom of the educational and economic heap. What does that mean? That means that you cannot do it by politics alone. How dare we put that kind of pressure on our political leadership? But again, we're no fools. We were born at night, but not last night. We didn't come over here with the last drop of rain. We do understand that we're all impacted by the politics of inclusion, right? And we're all impacted by public policy. So yes, we must continue to use the power of our vote to empower those who empower us. If they do not empower us, get them out of there. If they do not empower us, don't work for them. Why is wealth so critically important? Now listen to me on this. Your wealth will determine where you live. Where you live will determine where your children go to school. Where your children go to school will determine the quality of your children's higher education, and the quality of your children's higher education will determine their lifelong earnings. And your children's lifelong earnings will determine where your children live. And where your children live will determine where your grandchildren go to school. And where your grandchildren go to school will determine the quality of their higher education, and that ultimately will determine their lifelong earnings. Do you see the cycle of poverty here? Wealth is important. Why? Because in a market-based economy, in a democratic capitalistic society, at the end of the day, the only color that really matters is green. So until our pile of green is as big and as high and as deep and as wide and as leveraged as any other cultural group's pile of green, we will never be considered an equal at the table of democratic capitalism. Why is wealth important? Because wealth gives you unlimited choices. And yes, God wants us to have unlimited choices. And then it is the management of our choices that is the essence of living. Choices that give us the freedom to choose where our children go to school. Choices that give us the freedom to choose where we live and work. Choices to give us the freedom to choose where we play. Bible tells us, Ecclesiastes 10:19, money answers all things. Money and wealth is important. Why? Because when we finish pontificating ad nauseum about our issues, somebody's got to write a check. Our Jewish brothers and sisters, God bless them, can write a check. We must be able to write a check. Why is wealth important? I'm going to give you a little secret here. I don't want you to tell anybody I told you this. The tax system was designed for the landowner and the business owner. Why? Because landowners and business owners wrote the tax laws. So if we are not landowners, and in the African-American community, we own the fewest number of homes per capita of any cultural group in this country, and we came over here on the Mayflower. If you are not a business owner, and by the way, there are 14,000 pages of tax codes, which is really institutionalized corruption, which is designed for the business owner. And we own the fewest number of business, African Americans, of any cultural group in this country. And again, we've been here 400 years. So, if you are not a landowner and a business owner, you cannot fully exploit the American tax system. The tax system will exploit you. You will pay more taxes. So we must stop resenting rich and successful people, even when we don't mean it, because it cannot and you cannot attract what you resent. The distinctions between how very rich people think and how everyone else thinks is very clear. The very poor think day to day. The poor tend to think week to week. The middle class tends to think month to month. The rich think year to year. The very rich think decade to decade and generation to generation. And the primary goal of the very poor, and poor is survival. The primary goal of the middle class is comfort. And the primary goal of the rich and the very rich is freedom, the intergenerational transfer of wealth, and they will do whatever it takes to experience an abundance of freedom. Wealth and transferring that wealth to succeeding generations is critical. leaders understand this. Leaders understand the three things that clients and customers really want. You touched on a couple of them. What do they want? They want results. What is the greatest result that you can give any human being? Peace of mind. You've said that endlessly in the copy and the videos. People want peace of mind as a result. People, now this is going to sound a little strange, people want thrills. Now this is more difficult to quantify, but it is very, very important. People respond to heroism. They want a smart person working on their behalf. And if you can demonstrate that you are willing to work on their behalf and to do the hard work that they're not willing to do and to treat them like the kings and queens that they are, you will appeal to them. People want thrills and they respond to heroism, unusual efforts, extraordinary service. People have egos. And all of us want to feel important. So actually, people will cheer you on if you can demonstrate to them that you can treat them better than anybody else. There's another element of ego, and that's a variation on this ego thing, and that is being around good company. In other words, if you can communicate effectively to a person that they are involved and invested in something that really cool people and really smart people are invested in, that helps to assuage their ego. So people want results, they want thrills, they want to know that you are acting heroically on their behalf. And they want to know that you are standing by them, that they are being invested in something that is the coolest thing on the planet, the most evolutionary thing that there is. Leaders understand how to communicate that effectively. I see so much of it woven subconsciously into your collateral material. Also, to be a leader is to understand that you have to transcend being good at just functional and analytical or problem-solving tasks. That you must be able to build relationships, that's been talked about, that enable you to create a fabric of personal contacts that will provide you support, feedback, insight, resources, and information. That's called networking. You're going to have to spend your entire life cultivating, nurturing, and building relationships at work, at home, and in the community. You're going to have to spend every passage of your life. Each passage is about 10 years. And if you're lucky, you'll get 8 or 9 passages in life. Let me explain that to you. You're a different person at 10 than you were at 1. You're a different person at 20 than you were at 10. You're a different person at 30 than you were at 20. You're a different person at 40 than you were at 30. You're a different person at 50 than you were at 40. You're a different person at 60 than you were at 50. Let us pray. And you are a different person at 70 than you were at 60. I promise you that. There are passages in life. And so you're going to have to work on cultivating, nurturing, and building relationships at work, at home, and in the community through every passage of your life. You're going to have to work on a personal network. These are your close circle of friends. These are the people that cheer you on, lift you up, hug you. Let's say this is your network at home. You're going to have to work on what I call an operational network. These are the people that help you to get specific tasks done in life, whether it is in your place of business, whether it is in your church, whether you're on the deacon board, whether you're a volunteer. But these people platoon in and out of your life. They help you to get specific tasks done in your life, as you may help them to get specific tasks done in their life, and many move on. This is an operational network. And the final network that you're going to have to build is a strategic network. These are the people that are smarter than you. These are the people that will drag you into the 21st century kicking, screaming, and crying. These are the people that ultimately can be your coaches and mentors. We heard many references to that last night. So master networkers and leaders understand that networking really looks like this, that somebody is pulling you, and you must always be pulling someone. And the minute you break that connection in either direction, you have a hole in your net. And you know what happens when a fisherman gets a hole in his net? The fish get through, and too many holes, and the whole infrastructure of support breaks down. So you're going to have to work on, spend more time cultivating, nurturing, and building relationships. I wrote a book 23 years ago called Success Runs in Our Race, The Complete Guide to Effective Networking in the African American Community. I defined networking for our people. The book is a modern day classic. It is required reading at 57 historically black colleges. It is the book that started the networking conversation in black America and ultimately started the networking movement. And in that book, I defined networking. I said, Networking is the identification and the building of relationships for the purpose of sharing information, opportunities, and resources. And the emphasis on that definition is on the building of relationships and sharing. Why? Because all of life is about relationships. All of life is about working with and through other people. There is no success that you can attain, sustain, or maintain on your own, by yourself, in a vacuum. What am I really saying to you? Don't spend major time with minor people. People going nowhere want you to go nowhere with them. Really. People doing nothing want you to do nothing with them. If you want to change your life, brothers and sisters, change your relationships. This is huge. And it will require a high EQ to really build winning teams. Emotional intelligence, and Deborah talked about that. Managing your emotions and using the management of those emotions to cultivate, nurture, and to build relationships at work, at home, and in the community. And oftentimes, our emotions are out of control. How you comport yourself. How you understand that networking is really about giving. It is not about getting. That's the biggest mistake that people make in networking. You network to give, not get. If you're not giving, you're not getting. Debbie said that. That's just really how it works. You have to build winning teams to succeed in this business. And what do we know about that? That people do business with people that they know, that they respect, but most importantly, that they like. You see, I don't care what it is that you do. There are at least 10 people that can do what you do. And a few people can do it better than you. Right? So, I will do business with people that I know, respect, and I like. Your words are powerful. Awesomely powerful. We know that people do not leave businesses, they leave people. Did you know that? People don't leave bricks and mortars and doors and windows. They leave other people. So if you're leading people and they're coming to you on a regular basis saying, I will be leaving the organization or leaving the company, no. They're leaving your ass. That's what they're leaving. They're not leaving FFS. They're leaving you. Check yourself before you wreck yourself. Get a personality transplant. Stop trying to lead. This is hugely important, and you see this trait, this thread run through all of the successful team builders at FFS. Now, let me comment on something that Debbie so beautifully said, and I just want to edify what she said and back her up on that. Everything we do is so that someone will love us. It is all about love, And you can't start it like a car, and you can't stop it with a gun. That every single thing we do, brothers and sisters, is so that somebody will love us. The successes that we achieve, the clothes that we wear, we have an insatiable appetite to be loved. We can never stop hearing it. If someone told you 25 times a day that I love you, you would want more. So love is powerful. It is the most powerful thing, and the most successful leaders building winning teams, as Debbie said, love people. They really love people. And then the people we are in relationships with, we know, are always a mirror reflecting our own beliefs, and simultaneously we are mirrors reflecting their beliefs. And there are some who are not good for us. Now, this is hard stuff. I have been privileged to travel the world and meet some of the most successful people on the planet, from the Warren Buffetts of the world to the Bill Gates of the world. And what's interesting in Oprah, what's interesting about extraordinarily successful people is that they have one thing in common that is really never talked about and never really discussed, and no one has really ever written a book on this. But this thread runs through all of the successful people that I've met. Maybe it's just sort of this quiet thing. But really successful people have the ability to remove toxic people and bloodsuckers from their life. People who drain you of your time, your energy, and your patience. They have the unique ability to back away from those people. Now, this is very easy to say. This is extraordinarily difficult to do. You know why? Because most of these people are your family. In some cases, your significant others. In some cases, your, in quote, close friends. And those relationships look like a bowl of spaghetti. They do. You ever try to unravel yourself from those kinds of relationships? It's extraordinarily difficult to do. There's an old saying, if you love something, set it free. If it comes back, it will always be yours. If it doesn't come back, it was never yours to begin with. That's true. But there's a big but on that. If it sits in your living room, messes up all your stuff, eats all your food, uses your cell phone, takes your money, and doesn't appear to realize that you have set it free, you've either married it or you gave birth to it. This is huge. They will take you right down with them. Now, how do I know this to be profoundly true? To one model, and then I speak out of my own personal life. Our president, Barack Hussein Obama, had he not blessed and released his pastor of 20 years, who married him and Michelle and christened both of his children, had he not blessed and released his pastor, we would not have been calling him President Obama. It was a very difficult decision, but he had to get out of that relationship if he was to ascend to the presidency. This is his pastor. I know it's personally true because I grew up in foster care. My father came to this country in the early 1900s from Guyana. Married a beautiful, fair-skinned sister, Ida Mae Baldwin, from Lumpkin, Georgia, and we moved to Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn, New York, Bedford-Stuyvesant, the home of Jay-Z, Biggie Smalls, Chris Rock, Spike Lee, and Al Capone. A lot of people don't know. Al Capone is from Brooklyn. So if you're from Brooklyn, especially Bed-Stuy, you're one of two things. You're either a thug or a gangster. I'm a gangster. Absolutely. Debbie and Phil, gangsters. Shirley, gangsters. Shirley Lee and Lou and gangsters. They marched up on this stage, 25, that's gangster. My good friend Jay-Z redefined gangster for a modern culture. He said that gangster, the new gangster, is audacious measures to achieve the seemingly impossible. That's the new gangster. So we want you, when it's all said and done, to be gangster, okay? It's okay. I know my Asian brothers and sisters are gangsters. I saw them. So they moved to Brooklyn, New York. They had 11 children, 8 boys and 3 girls. My mother became mentally ill when I was 3. My father, because he couldn't get a good education and get a good job in the early 1900s as a beautiful black man, he was relegated to driving a New York City cab for 40 years of his life. But he was Caribbean, so from the islands. And so they call our Caribbean brothers and sisters black Jews. And so what did my father do? He bought a medallion in the early 1930s. Do you know what a medallion is worth? Which means he owned his own cab in the 1930s. He bought it for $15,000, which was a lot of money then. Now you can't get one in New York. It'll cost you over $1 million. So Dad was entrepreneurial. But he had to work 12 to 15 hours a day. He could not take care of 11 children, so we were orphaned. So I was in an orphanage from 3 to 5. And because nobody would take 11 children, we were broken up into threes, and I spent my life, young life, in foster care, in toxic foster homes, growing up on the mean streets of New York. I aged out of foster care. Now, fortunately, unlike so many foster children that have no place to go, when they age out and they end up homeless, about 30 to 35% of foster children end up homeless. They have no place to go when the money runs out because you get paid to take care of children. And it's almost an industry. I'm not degrading foster care. It is, we need to work on it, but there are a lot of children that do not do well in foster care. That's a whole nother story. So my father maintained a brownstone in Brooklyn, New York. And so that's where I went back to at 18 years old. Now, I was met by older brothers who had aged out before me. But the difference between them and me was they were heroin addicts, and one was a heroin dealer. I wrote about my brother Joseph, who was killed in a drug deal that went bad. He was killed with his 3 best friends. They weren't trying to kill his friends. They were just trying to kill Joseph. The friends happened to be with him that day when they went and got him. So, you know, be careful who your friends are, all right? Be careful who your friends are. So here I am in my own household, 4 brothers who are addicted to heroin. So God said to me, you got to get out of here. So as soon as I was able, I packed up what little I had, got on a Greyhound bus and went to Cleveland, Ohio, which is where I live now. And my oldest sister took me in. So, what I'm saying to you is that there will be people that will come into your life who are toxic, and that you must simply bless them and release them, or they will take you down, they will take you out. There may be people in your organization who are toxic, and you must identify that quickly and bless them and release them from your organization, because smart people rarely hang around stupid people unless they're related to them. All right? And the less you associate with some people, the more your life will improve. And anytime you tolerate mediocrity in others, it increases your mediocrity. And an important attribute in successful people is their impatience with negative thinking and negative acting people. So know that when God wants to get into your life, God will send a person. When the devil wants to get into your life, the devil will send a person. Your task in life is to determine which one is which and who has been sent by whom. Our enemies have been anointed to have us do those things that we would never consider doing. It is written in the 23rd Psalm. If you are a Christian, you've read the 23rd Psalm. And I quote the passage in the 23rd Psalm, "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of thy enemy." Be careful. I close with a piece that I wrote about 20 years ago. To make a difference. Is that too much to ask? To make a difference, is that too much to ask? Dr. King said to us that the purpose of life is to matter, to count, to have it make some difference that we lived at all. I have been blessed to have been given the opportunity to spend my professional life in service of others. I have chased excellence and not money. Let me say that again. Chase excellence, never chase money. When you become excellent at whatever it is that you do, you will not be able to get out of the way of money. I have worked for Procter & Gamble. I've done work as a volunteer for the 100 Black Men, the United Way of America, Ford Motor Company, the United Negro College Fund, the National Black MBAs, and countless others. And I, of course, had my own business, which is engaged in social entrepreneurship for almost 30 years. So the question that we must ask is, what kind of challenge is facing us that we might look at individually and collectively, brothers and sisters, so that we may and might find a way to make a difference? I have always known that when people everywhere are faced with a challenge, a solution will be found and the problem will be fixed. Sometimes it just takes a while, sometimes it takes a little bit longer, but just for a moment, think about some truly notable and courageous people. People like Dr. King, Rosa Parks, Nelson Mandela, people like Buddha and Confucius and Cesar Chavez and Chief Joseph. They were confronted almost with insurmountable challenges, and they faced them down because they all believed in their mission. And one person with a belief is worth more than 99 people with an opinion. Opinions are like, no, I'm not going to say that. But you know what I'm going to say. Since the time that these people were born, many battles have been fought and won, but some have been lost. And among those that I fear we are losing are the hearts and minds and souls of our children. Our future depends upon our children. I said this earlier. So I ask you rhetorically, where have all the heroes gone? Because I see you as heroes. Some people want a religion that will make them feel respectable but does not require them to be there. There are blatant attempts to make ours a godless society, and for the past 30 years, the Supreme Court has used the Constitution and the Bill of Rights to gird this argument. I have been fortunate to have traveled to Rome, the seat of the Roman Empire. And the excesses of the past are still there to see and to imagine even now. And as you walk through the Colosseum, if you've been there, your mind tricks you into thinking that you can see and hear and smell man's inhumanity to man and beast. It was Edward Gibbons in 1788 who set forth in his famous book, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, five reasons why that great civilization withered and died. Number one, the undermining of the dignity and sanctity of the home, which is the basis for human society. Number two, wealth disparity. higher and higher taxes and the spending of public money for free bread and circuses for the populace. Number three, the mad craze for pleasure, where sports and plays became more exciting, more brutal, and more immoral. Number four, the building of great armaments when the real enemy was within, the decay of individual responsibility. And number five, the decay of religion, whose leaders lost touch with life and their power to guide. It's a very sobering list, isn't it? And regardless of the protesters and those who discount it, we must continue to keep faith as the foundation of our society. And for those who pray as they should, we'll endeavor to live as they pray. Rosa Parks knew that it was not right to have to go to the back of the bus. She would say that little by little we have learned that women, that all people must be treated more equally, and that racial progress has been steady but yet too slow. I would say that we must value the world in which we live and celebrate our differences, because the melting pot is being supplanted by a gumbo pot, and rather than trying to boil everything down to make this one soup, all of these ingredients are needed to make our lives in this world and this country interesting. It is right for America to accept itself. I think finally we are getting it. Diversity is God's gift and God's great experiment. And if we rise to this challenge, I believe we will. We will. Over time, we will be judged the greatest civilization ever created. If we do not rise to this challenge, we will simply go the way of the great Roman Empire. Ladies and gentlemen, this is our challenge. You are doing this work. I am seeing this in living color. This is your challenge. This is my challenge, to make a difference, to matter. I was doing an interview not long ago, and the interviewer asked me, Dr. Fraser, what would you like on your tombstone? And then I teared up, and I said it would be very simple. My name. And then underneath my name, the words, "He mattered." He mattered. To make a difference. To make a difference. We must make a difference not by the conspicuousness of our silence, but by speaking out when things are wrong. The philosopher Maimonides said, "If not now, when? If not me, who?" So, let me sum this up with a short poem. Fortunate are the persons who in this life can find a purpose that can fill their days and goals that fill their mind. For in this world, there is a need for those who will lead the rest to rise above the average life by giving of their best. Will you be one who dares to try when challenged by the task to rise to heights you've never seen? Or is that too much to ask? Where have all of our heroes gone? Those who dared, those who dream, who lifted and inspired us to understand that in the end, the purpose of life is to matter, to count, to have it make some difference that we lived at all. I want you to take the hand of the person on the left and the person on the right, and I close with a short prayer. May we always remember those who have gone before us. May we be inspired by their vision and their valor. May their lives continually remind us that service is more important than success, that people are more important than possessions, that principle is more important than power. May whatever we do be shaped and molded by honesty, excellence, and commitment. May our children and our children's children carry forth with pride the nobility of the histories that are represented here and the various traditions that are represented in this room. To the Creator of all of us, by whatever name we may refer to that Creator, we dedicate our lives to make this world better and more beautiful. I want you to repeat after me with enthusiasm. I want you to say this with enthusiasm. I want you to say, this is not about me.
This is about
we.
It takes teamwork
to make the dream work.
We have the timber.
Let us build.
God bless you,
and thank you very much.